it's a plan meeting for on the Zoom platform. We encourage people to join for those ones who can join on Zoom. It is a very good time. And now we need to get closer to our Lord. And that is a wonderful opportunity for us to get together and do the prayer meeting together. There's nowhere else we can get strength in our Christian world. The only way we get together and pray. Pray as a family, a church family, and also we are encouraged also to do our own prayer. To be in communion with our Creator. So that will be your own time for it to find. But what is the prayer meeting? Is that also a good time for us to be together as a church? We are appreciating because the attendance is very good. This last days. And we continue to encourage everyone to join our school. Please be ready. And the time is 7 o'clock. It's no longer 7:30. It's 7 o'clock. Another announcement is on Thursday, as usual, is a board meeting. So we are announcing this to both members to arrange this time. That will be 7 o'clock on Thursday. It's all announcement that I have. The rest I wish you a blessing as we go to worship together. May God bless you.
Thank you. Father, we'd like to thank you for this beautiful service. Thank you that you've allowed us to come and feast at your feet. May you forgive us our trespasses as we come before your throne of the Father. That as we speak to you, the Holy Spirit might minister in our hearts, and may our life forever change. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'll read from Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. And the same day, when the evening was come, he said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him, even as he was in the ship. And they were also with him at the little ship. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And as he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow, and they awake him, and they say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind, and said unto the sea, peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, why are ye so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly, and said one to another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen.
Let us all stand as we're going to open our service with hymn number 524.
Just
We're going to pray, but before we do that, I would like to invite the congregation to bring prayer requests. Any prayer requests? If there's no more request,
my family,
yes. Okay, so let us kneel down for those of them. Thank you. Our kind, gracious Heavenly Father, what a wonderful privilege do we have to find ourselves in the house of worship. Lord, we have come before the throne of mercy this morning to worship you. We know that we are not good in your sight. Lord, we have come with empty hearts and we want you to fill us, your blessings. We want to pray for us to be cleansed, Lord, from our iniquity that we have done in our past. Lord, accept our worship as we have come before you. Lord, we want for this day you have given us a day of rest be very useful to us to renew our relationship with you. Do not let any one of us to lose this opportunity, Lord. Help us to remain focused, especially in this holiday that you have given us since the creation of this earth. And this is recurring day, weekly, Lord, we pray that you may help us to increase our faith in serving you. Lord, we have come to worship you. What we want the angels and the Holy Spirit to be with us. And help us also to open our eyes, spiritual eyes, open our hearts, open our minds, Lord, to communion with you today. We also have come with so many burdens. Each and every one of us does have the challenges. And by our own, there's nothing we can do. That's why, Lord, we are taking all your burdens to you as you promised us. And take all our burdens from us. Burdens about our sins. Burdens about whatever is taking over our life. Burdens of the challenges in our lives. Lord, you remind us that you are a Father in heaven who cares about every one of us. And do not let any one of us try to fight yourself, because whenever we fight, we fail. We want you, Lord, to fight on our behalf. And help us to always stand firm, especially these last days that we are living in. And soon, as Jesus is coming, we pray that you may find each one of us ready to meet you. Lord, there are some prayer requests. Those ones who are not feeling good, don't feeling who are sick, we pray that you may bring healing upon them. We have been praying for their family, you know, all challenges that we are going through. But we trust you can resolve any problem that we are facing. We keep on praying for them. And also, we want also to pray for those who are backsliding, who no longer walk in this walk. It is very sad, because out of you there is no life. We pray that those ones who got lost, Lord, to help them come back in the front. At this point in time, Lord, we want to pray for Sister Vivian, whom we gave the word to speak to your people. We pray that you may keep her and give her words to say, so that whatever she will be saying will be helpful to all of us. Let us not only hear your words, but let us apply it in our life. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church. Our offertory reading of today is August 28, 2021, and say local conference advance. And it read as follows. A member moved into his new home. The house had walls, wall carpet. He never thought of what may be underneath the carpet. Then one day, as he looked into one of his children's rooms, he noticed a partition left in the carpet. He looked closer and found rich oak wood flooring underneath. He could not believe his eyes. When he moved the rake from that room, He discovered that all the wood floor needed was a little sanding and fresh coat of polish. The ordinary room was transformed into a majestic room. Room by room, he removed the wrecks and revealed the hidden beauty. Within weeks, the entire home changed into a mansion. Today, you and I are born in a sin. The world tries to cover us in an attempt to make us feel beautiful while ignoring the fact that underneath is God's creation. Our Lord sees us as his workmanship. His goal is to restore us to our original place. He wants us to become elegant, rich in tone, and unique in design. When we place ourselves into his hand, he removes the layers of sin and pain and recreates us into his image. The Bible says, for we are his men workmanship, created in Christ Jesus into good works, which God had before ordained that we should walk in them. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. And the appeal this morning says, by your gift today, the gospel message can open new doors to let hope and transformation touch the lives of others. In this way, I would like to ask the deacon and deaconess to collect the morning tithes and offering. Let us pray. Thank you, dear God. Before we lift our hand and giving back what belongs to you, the whole portion was entitled to our duties. But as you've given this, allow it to go and perform your duty as we are waiting for your second return. This we pray and believe in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, church. Good morning, church.
Amen.
Ah, thank you very much. Yes, it's cold outside, but I believe inside it must be warm. It is a great privilege for us to be in God's house. Is really, we don't realize it, we don't even, sometimes we take it for granted, but it is a privilege to find ourselves in the house of in the house of our Father in heaven. I think we have been experiencing something which was not good for many years, but we need to thank God for us to be, to enjoy. To be able to enjoy this privilege. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. I want to welcome everyone here, regular members, and welcome, as usual. When we get together and worship our Creator, it is really for us a good thing to be, to experience. And also, as usual, we have visitors. among us, and I want to welcome new visitors. We have some new names here. The Kayunda, the Kenya. Can you please raise your hand? People can welcome you.
Amen.
And Isaac Musenda.
Amen.
Musonda. Yes, okay. Well, very welcome. And we also do have Agnes Kadzungi. Yes, Agnes. Atenda Mpepi. Thank you for coming. Is any other visitor did not mention? Don't see anyone else. We also have the privilege to be with Pastor Higa. Pastor Higa is not a visitor, but we are so blessed whenever we are with him. So we want to welcome all of you. You're welcome. We're going to share the word. We're going to share the bread of life. I want you to feel welcome as we're going to get this blessing. At this point in time, I want to welcome Sister Vivian. Sister Vivian is not a visitor here. She's one of one of the church members. But I want to say something about Vivian. Vivian is someone who is willing to serve every time, every time. He does not hesitate when it comes to serve. I really want to appreciate that. And I believe God is going to use her as she's going to break the bread of life. And at this point in time, I want to welcome her on this.
Thank you, Elder Lambert. Always encouraging, in as much as we work for the Lord, and we get affirmation that whatever is put to good, not for people, but for the children of God to come into His kingdom. This Sabbath church. I'm looking at my time and I'm going to have to fly through my sermon because and the topic of my sermon today is calm in the storm. And our message is coming from Mark chapter 4, from verse 35 to 41. I'd like to firstly greet all the Weinberg church members here physically and those watching us on our Zoom platforms. I also want to extend my greetings to our visitors among us. May God help us as we listen to Him speak. I want to share with us the word of God from Mark chapter 4, verses 35, 41. You can open your Bibles. And I want us to focus on the calm in the storm. And the calm in the storm today is not a thing, but the calm in the storm is a person. And it's no other person than Jesus Christ Himself. I thank God that we have set aside this day to come and acknowledge Him and sit at His feet this beautiful Sabbath and listen to Him speak to us from our hearts. He knows what we are going through, that we are confused, that we are afraid, and that we are worried about this pandemic. But today we trust God and we speak against fear, and we'll see every opportunity in this situation to even glorify His name. Can anyone read the text, or shall I read? Can anyone read the text? We can read it again, or Mark chapter 4, verse 35.
Mark chapter 4, verse 35 says, and the same day when the evening was come, and He said unto them, let us pass all over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little sheep. 37. And there arose a great storm and wind, and the waves beat unto the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awakened him, and say unto him, Master, dost thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind, and say unto the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Verse 40. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that he have no faith? Amen.
May the Lord bless the reading of the word. I want to speak to you today about the calm in the storm. The calm in the storm. The truth of our topic lies in the fact that even in the midst of the storm, we must calm. Because we are all flustered and confused does not mean that God is not there. It does not mean that this is all to what is happening. Because our environment may be chaotic doesn't mean that there isn't calm there. Wherever Jesus is, there is calm. But we must acknowledge and receive it. While many of us read and make light of the reaction of the disciples when they found themselves in crisis and scared, how many times in our lives have we ended up in the very same place? How many times in our lives we begin with Jesus, but somewhere along the journey, we forget that he is there until we are faced with unexpected turbulence. And after we have done all that we can in our mind, we then remember and cry unto him. I cannot resist the typological realities of this scripture. Let us look at the sea. The sea reminds us that regardless of what we do, we are simply a speck in it. And we have no control over our lives. The boat as it is presents us with the reality of a constructed system that we have designed for ourselves to remain safely afloat and to get to where we are going successfully. But we forget that sometimes danger just lets everywhere. But the disciples today represent each and every one of us. And you might be looking at me and wondering what is coming out of the wind. We are represented in this text. As I read this, I can't help but seeing myself as an individual and humanity represented here in the picture of the disciples. Let us look firstly at the fact that the journey belongs to God, not to us. Jesus Christ tells them, let's cross over to the other side. Many times in life, we believe that the journey belongs to us, but this journey of life belongs to him. The reality is that at one place there in their lives, they thought they were safe. There was calm there. There was not a problem there. But Jesus says to them, let us cross over to the other side. The reality of life is that we must remember that during our lives, we will encounter storms. You see, remaining in the same place because of the possibility of a storm will imprison you and I. It is better that the storm comes while we are in the process of God's will rather than stuck in our same place of disbelief. Jesus is an important part of this scenario because he said, let's go. We are going. This paragraph reveals a critical issue first with us as Christians, because many of us begin with Jesus in the boat. I remember when I was baptized and I was 16. When I came out of the baptismal pool, the zeal, the fire, the desire to know more about Christ and to go in there. But sometime during the journey, he sees engaging him. And so much so that he's virtually asleep in our lives. I want to assure you that Jesus being asleep has nothing to do with the fact that he's asleep as God, because he isn't. But it is the reality to you and I that because we have shut him out of our lives for so long, that to us is asleep. You see, some might ask, how do we shut Jesus out? I'll ask you just a few questions. Do you talk to him in prayer? Do you read the word daily? Are you returning your time? Have you been spreading the gospel recently? You need not answer my fellow brothers and sisters. It is between you. I'll also like to read something from Sister Ellen White from Desire of Ages, chapter 35. And it says, absorbed in the effort to save themselves, they had forgotten that Jesus was on board. Now seeing their labor vain and only death before them, they remembered at whose command they set out across the sea. In Jesus was their only hope. In their helplessness and despair, they cried, Master, Master. But the dense darkness hid him from their sight. Their voices were drowned by the roaring of the tempest, and there was no reply. Doubt and fear assailed them. And Jesus forsaken them? Was he who had conquered disease, demons, and even death powerless to help his disciples? Was he unmindful of them in their distress? That is page 334, paragraph 4. The reason for this is because we take every journey as the same, and we forget that there is no guarantee that it will be the same as the one we last took. No doubt these individuals had traversed these waters many times, but somehow on this occasion it was different. No doubt you may be saying today that you have been living life for 50 years, 40 years, 30 years, and this has never happened before. That's the nature of life. We forget that Jesus is now. On the same chapter of Desire of Ages, I will read how often the disciples experience this hour. When the tempest of temptation gathers and the fierce lightnings flash and the waves sweep over us, we battle with the storm alone, forgetting that there is one who can help us. We trust in our own strength till our hope is lost and we are ready to perish. Then we remember Jesus. And if we call upon him to save us, we shall not cry. Though he softly reproves our unbelief and self-confidence, he never fails to give us the help we need. Whether on land or on sea, if we have the Savior in our hearts, there is no need for fear. Living faith in the Redeemer will smooth the sea of life and will deliver us from danger in the way that he knows best. As Isaiah pages, page 36, brother. Moving on, the other point we need to remember is that others are on that very same journey. As I paid careful attention to the scripture, I recognized that the Bible says there were also other little ships. How significant is that? It is important that while we sail in this boat, Jesus is in our ship. That though the storm will rage as it is today with the global pandemic, it is important that we stay in the same boat with Jesus. That while others wail in distress, we in our storm might lift up our eyes to Christ and find our calm in the storm. Though fear might be in every one of us, we have the hope of Christ. In this journey, we may be the ones to whom safety comes to others. When you have Jesus in the boat, he is not just there for your safety alone, brothers and sisters, but he is there that because of you, safety might come to others. Imagine all the other boats going through the same storm and being in the very same situation. And here it is, Jesus in the disciples' boat And because of his presence in their lives, things changed for everyone. I want to encourage you as a child of God. You may not think much of it. You may be thinking that it's going to pass over and that you are very safe because your boat is very big. But you need to understand that things may quickly get to a place that will overwhelm even your boat. But there is someone that is waiting. There is an individual who right now needs you. That person is about to see you. And they need you to call upon the God that you know. That situations can change, not just for you, but for them too. Today, let us understand from this that if as a people of faith, many of us are being shaken by the storm, then what is happening to those who have not? The reality is we are not the only ones in Peru. Many individuals that are connected to us are dispersed. But the significant thing is that we know that Jesus is in our world. And I want to say to us as children of God, there are people that have heard you profess Christ. They know Jesus is in the boat with you. And they are looking at you. They are looking at you for faith. They are looking at you for a word of encouragement. And this is the time for you as a child of God to understand your God and never be fearful to share with him, to share him with others. They need him now more than ever. The other thing we need to acknowledge is that something worked before doesn't mean it's going to work forever. These men were fishermen. That boat was most likely built by them. That's an assumption. They understood this boat inside as a prayer. These men had made a living fishing on the boat. These were seasoned fishermen. The place where they were was familiar. They were used to the sea. They knew the portion of the sea because they had been there before. But there comes a time in life when the thing that we think we know best fails. The very thing that had worked for time and time again, it worked for your grandparents, for your parents, but it might not work for you. You get to a point in life where you face a storm, where the thing that worked yesterday is not working today. Today you may have faith in your business. You may have had faith in your employment, you may have had faith in your intellectual abilities, you may have faith in your qualifications, but today, none of these men. We are all in the same boat. Things are now difficult for everyone in one way or the other because of the pandemic. The fishermen had some faith, not just in the boat, but they also had some faith in themselves. After all, they could be considered experts. They had known the sea for so long, perhaps, from the time they were young. But here it is, on that very place, there was a problem. There are times when familiar environments begin to show signs of unfamiliarity. What do you do? These are the times when God gets our attention. These are the times when we begin to reduce our interest in life and begin to do elimination of priorities and recognize that the things that we held onto are not that important, are not that necessary, and are not the safest things in life. You thought that you had it, capital I, capital T. It represents different things that we as people value. It might represent the job that you had, you thought you had, was it. The circumstances around them begin to enter, and you realize that that job is no longer there. You might have thought that the company you started was it, until the global economy starts to threaten it and its ability to remain afloat. You see, the danger is not the boat on the sea. The danger is not the boat on the sea, and it is only dangerous when the boat begins to sink, when the conditions outside begin to affect us. Inside, then it becomes difficult. When you thought your family was it, until the stress of the environment begins to come home and the home becomes filled with anger, misunderstanding over simple things, that's what stress does. It pulls on you and your family. When you are faced with all these problems, that is the time on. Come to think of it, the calm was present even before the storm. What I have recognized in my life is that Jesus has always been there in my life, even before the storm. We have seen the pandemic ravishing the young and the old, and there's nothing we can rely on except the blood of Jesus. A singer once said, "What can make me whole again? Nothing but blood of Jesus." What can protect you in this season? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. The scriptures say Jesus retreated to the inner parts of the ship. In this case, Jesus, in essence, has retreated to the inner parts of our lives, so as not to bother us. We have been so busy with our lives that he has basically been relegated to the back of the ship. He is asleep, not because he doesn't want to commune with us, but he doesn't want to disturb the focus, because we've been focused on everything else in our lives but God. He doesn't want to get in the way of you focusing on your family, that new marriage that you have. He doesn't want to get in the way because he is a graceful God, and he doesn't want to get in your way of your new job that you just accepted, even though you knew you would be working on Sabbath. But I thank God that regardless of what we do, he is still present. He has not left the ship. He has the ability to leave us, but he still remains there because he knows that somewhere down the line, the storm. And that you will need him. What a great Savior. That even after being put to the back of the ship, if we call him, he brings calm. The psalmist David says, "I cried out to the Lord, and he heard me, and he delivered me from all my trouble." You see, Jesus steps forward gracefully because he is a forgiving God, and he steps forward in our times of protest. He speaks. The scripture here is so profound in that within all the chaos, calm was present. My beloved brothers and sisters, always remember this. With all the chaos in the world, God is still there. God is the calm in the storm. Jesus was never bothered by the storm because he knew he was. Calm in this instance is not a state of affairs or an environment, but calm in this instance as a person, and that person is Jesus. He is the Prince of Peace, and he waits for you to turn to him for help. In closing, I will read Desire of Ages, chapter 35, from the headings, Peace, Peace, Peace. There is another spiritual lesson in this miracle, the stilling of the tempest. Every man's experience testifies to the truth of words of scripture. The wicked are like a troubled sea when it cannot rest. There is no peace, save God, to the wicked. Sin has destroyed our peace. While self is answered, we can find no rest. The masterful passions of the heart, no human power can control. We are as helpless as were the disciples who quiet the raging storm. But he who spoke peace to the billows of Galilee has spoken the word of peace for every soul. However fierce the tempest, those who turn to Jesus with the cry, Lord, save us, will find His grace that reconciles the soul to God, quiets the strife of human passion, and in His love, the heart is blessed. He maketh the storm the calm, so that the waves thereof are still. Then they are glad, because they be quiet. So He bringeth them unto their desire. Being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus. The work of righteousness shall be peace, and the effect of righteousness, quietness, and assurance forever. May the Lord bless the reading of His word. Amen.
Thank you, Sister Vivian. At this moment, we're going to close our service to hymn number 522. 522.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you have been with us. Thank you, Lord, that you came unto each and every one of us. May we receive your calm in our lives, so that while the storms are raging around us, we remember to lift up our eyes unto you. And may you help each and every one of us who are faced different kinds of storms, that we might not be able to disclose one to another. But you are a Lord that seeth all. May you meet us at our point of need. And we are grateful that, Lord, you have allowed us to hear this word. And for that, we say thank you, because now we know that in every situation, you are always present with us. We pray that you might be with us as we start a new week. Guide us and protect us. May the storms of life not wither us from worshiping you. May we stand steadfast and remember that you are coming soon, Lord. And may each and every one of our members who are here, those who are watching on our Zoom, and all the Adventist family, May we be reminded that you are not the God that lies, and that we may tighten our belts and wait on your soon coming, that our names might be written in the book of life to come to collect us. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
I love the Lord because he hath heard my voice in supplications, because he hath inclined his ear unto me, therefore will I call upon him, the name of the Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, deliver my soul. It's toward me. I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord, the name of the Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, deliver my soul. Supplications, because